Last hour, we told you about William Shatner's newest role. He is acting out his own life story, that is, in a one-man show that's called Shatner's World. We just live in it. I like that title. But many of you remember him, of course, from what is undeniably his most famous role, and that was Captain Kirk in Star Trek. My colleague Don Lemon talked to Shatner, and he got the inside look at the show.
You share what many consider the first interracial kiss on American television. Did you realize how groundbreaking that moment was?
Not in terms of groundbreaking. I just realized how lovely her lips were.
Really? So that's all you thought about?
Anything that was breaking there might have been her lips, but not groundbreaking in terms of a racial kiss, no. She was and is a beautiful woman.
This was the 1960s. Were you worried at all about your career and that it would have any sort of detrimental effect on your career by, you know, sharing a kiss with an African-American woman?
It never occurred to me, no.
I've got a real geeky Star Trek question for you. I was a Trekkie. Who would win in a fight, okay, Captain Kirk or Captain Picard? Because I understand that you and Patrick Stewart are good friends in real life.
We are. In real life, he could probably kick my ass. In fiction, I'd kick his ass.
Come on.
Can you say ass on
right. Of course you can. Yes, and you are okay, Captain Kirk.
You're right, and I would have kicked his ass. But realize this, Patrick Stewart was a boxer as a kid. Yeah. He had a boxing, he went to boxing school and all. So mm-hmm. It would be an interesting fist fight if we had pillows on our fists to see who would win.
The new Star Trek, I'm not sure if you've seen it, but it seems to be very violent, lots of explosions, and I mean, it's a different kind of Star Trek.
Well,
what do you think of it?
Exactly. I mean, J.J. Abrams is a great filmmaker, and the way he has brought a major audience into the franchise is to make a ride. So the Star Trek becomes one of those rides with explosions and action and the wonderful people they've got playing the roles. He has made Star Trek popular once again with a far larger audience. So he seems to be doing the right thing. The Star Treks that we were in told a more personal story, told a story that had more soul to it, if you will. But the large screen encourages explosions and shoot 'em ups.
You and Leonard Nimoy have worked together on and off for the past 50 years now, starting even before Star Trek with the Man from U.N.C.L.E. in 1964, Mission Impossible.
Boy.
He was the best man at one of your weddings. Do you guys still hang out?
We don't see each other very much now. Life has taken us apart, but he's a dear, dear man.
Can you make that hand symbol? I heard that you can't make it.
No,
live long and prosper.
I can't make it. It's sort of, there's a finger up in the air somewhere, but I'm not quite sure what it is.
What people don't know about you and what I didn't know in doing my research is that you have raised millions of dollars for children's charity. You're very kind. You have a soft spot for certain things. How did you get involved in that? I mean, you also auctioned off a kidney stone for Habitat for Humanity. A lot of pain did a lot of good.
A lot of uric acid went that way. That's true. the salient thing, the thing that I never forget is that every human being has their story, as we talked about earlier, has their need for respect, has their spirit, their soul.
Right.
And you can never forget that. No matter what the person's circumstances are, the one-man show, I touch on this note, we're on that journey together, the journey through to death. And we don't know what's on the other side of that line of death. So we're locked in this embrace of the journey and the apprehension of what happens after we die. And it seems to suggest, and I make this point in that show, that we should help each other to make that journey easier and more meaningful.